So I'm Heather McElroy. I'm the Natural Resource Manager at the Cape Cod Commission. I'm joined here this evening with a number of Cape Cod Commission staff who may chime in at some point, as well as Joe Famley of the Woods Hole Group. Joe and I will give the presentation this evening. And great, thank you for entering your names in the chat. So let's see, I guess I need to request control. Here we go. All right, so just so everyone sort of understands what our purpose is here this evening, we've been engaged in this low-lying roads project for the last year or so. I'm gonna give you sort of a high-level overview of that project. We're going to spend the bulk of the meeting reviewing some adaptation alternatives that have been developed for three different road segments in the town of Brewster. And then there will be an opportunity to discuss the advantages and disadvantages of those alternatives. So our agenda here, we hope to be finished within an hour and a half, likely less than that, sort of depending on, you know, questions and any discussion. I'll give a project overview, sort of where we've been to date. If there are any town comments that the town wanted to make, I'm happy to take those. And then I'll be turning it over to Joe Famley, who will spend some time providing a detailed overview of the different design alternatives that he and his team at the Woods Hole Group have developed for these three different road segments. Route 6A at Betty's Curve, a segment of Lower Road, and also Route 6A at Quivett Creek. We'll pause for questions as we go along. And if there's any discussion to be had, you know, sort of related to advantages and disadvantages of the different alternatives, happy to have that. And then we have a few slides at the end regarding next steps. So this project started out working with 10 towns shown here, with funding from the Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program, as well as Economic Development Administration. We've been using that money to conduct a vulnerability assessment of transportation infrastructure in each of these towns. We've developed a framework for helping communities prioritize the vulnerable roads and transportation infrastructure that's been identified. And then we've been developing design alternatives for each of two or three different road segments in each of those towns. I say we started with these 10 towns because we've now received additional MVP funding to do the same work in the remaining five Cape Cod communities. We started this work in September 2021, about a year and a half ago now, conducted that vulnerability assessment and prioritized the roadway segments that were identified through that assessment. Joe's going to give you a little bit more detail about that process. Our findings from that work were presented at our first workshop about a year ago, where we had an opportunity to hear back from the community and identify, begin to hone in on the road segments that would become the second phase of the project. Last summer, we made site visits to look at the vulnerable roads, and in the intervening time have been developing some of the design alternatives that will be presented this evening. So there's, sort of a lot of detailed analysis that has gone into this project. And there's a nice, very nice, I think, clear overview of that work on our low-lying roads website, which is at on the capecodcommission.org website. If you just Google Cape Cod Commission and low-lying roads, you'll come to that page. There's a specific page just for the work that's been done for the town of Brewster. So you can go there, and there are a number of tabs that allow you to explore the information that's been developed, including the recording of the prior meeting that happened about a year ago, the slide deck that was presented, and we'll be posting the recordings from this meeting as well as the slide deck in the, you know, the coming days after this evening is over. So I encourage you to check that out for any sort of background understanding that you'd like to have related to this project. So I'll pause here, see if there are any clarifying questions about our purpose this evening, and just encourage you to use the raise hand function if you want to ask a question or put something in the chat. And thank you, Tara, for putting that link in the chat to the Low-Lying Roads webpage. So not seeing any hands, I'm going to turn it over to Joe, but just to indicate that our format this evening is Joe's going to present three designs for each of those three different road segments. He'll pause after he's presented on each road segment to ask for any clarifying questions. And if there's any desire to sort of debate the advantages or disadvantages, I'd like to just ask to wait to put that to the end of the presentation of all three road segments so that we make sure that we can get through content. But we do want to be able to answer questions and help you to understand the work that's been done and to hear any feedback that you might have. So with that, I will turn it over to Joe.
Thanks, Heather. Sure, I have control here. Yep. Okay. So as Heather mentioned, there's a lot of great resources on the Low-Lying Roads website. You can look at the prior slide decks and workshop recording to really get into detail and look at the map viewers on their website to get a real in-depth view of some of the data that went into this. I'm going to do a really quick overview of the process that got us to the road segments that we took a look at for adaptation planning. So just a reminder, this is a coastal vulnerability assessment and adaptation planning project. The hazards, the climate-related hazards that we're concerned with are sea level rise and storms. And, I think I got muted for a second there. So the climate-related hazards that we're looking at here are sea level rise and storm surge. And first, I'll just give a brief indication of sea level rise in Brewster, which obviously is based on your topography, not much of a concern. It's also borne out by sort of the relative proportion of our assessment area, which is kind of confined to this narrow strip on the bay side, because once you get up a little bit into the town from the bay, you've got pretty high elevations. So very little high tide flooding projected over time, given the state's sea level rise projections that inform a lot of this climate planning. However, there were a few segments, and two of them, Betty's Curve and 6A at the town line, were among the ones that were selected for further investigation and planning. So the other part of this assessment was, you know, what's coastal flooding going to do over time with sea level rise and more frequent and more intense storms? And we wanted to do a more detailed look at that. We compared elevations of the road network on a very fine resolution to results of the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model, which was developed using those sea level rise projections and a hydrodynamic probabilistic approach to get a sense of the water surface elevations associated with a range of probability storms over time. And so those are the annual exceedance probabilities that you see there. They range from 0.1%, which is a very low probability, high intensity storm. That's roughly a 1,000-year recurrence interval, all the way to the 100%, which would be the annual chance, your annual storm. In between that range, I'll just point out, and you'll see this on some of the maps, is a 1% annual chance exceedance probability. That you can think of as a 100-year recurrence interval. It's a similar statistic to what FEMA calculates for their flood maps. This is just factoring in other things like sea level rise and storms that are changing over time. So comparing those elevations of the road to the projected water surface elevations, we got an assessment of the vulnerability. So the probability of flooding along the roadway. And we wanted to help towns prioritize roadways over time, not just based on vulnerability. So just because a road floods doesn't mean that it's necessarily the top priority, right? Is it a highly used road? Does it go through a business district? Does it support vulnerable populations? Does it provide access to either primary or secondary access to critical community and emergency services? So all those factors went into a criticality assessment. And then we took those two factors, probability and criticality, to look at risk. So we combined those two things and then presented you all and the town staff with a list of high priority roads for them to select for further planning and design. Just a quick example of all of those different factors. This is a flood risk map comparing the water surface elevation from the flood risk model to the elevations of the roadway. And you see the range of probabilities going from 0.1% in the pink to 100% in the dark blue. Again, very limited, even under high sea level rise, long-term conditions. This 2070 map is showing, you know, a mile of roads throughout the town subject to flooding in an annual storm, and only 5.6 miles under a really extreme storm long in the future. But there were some areas that were of concern. We intersected that with the criticality score, factoring in all of those parameters that I just noted before. You see the higher scores or the warmer colors kind of concentrated along the main corridor 6A and lower road as well. And combining those two factors, we get risk. So this is long-term 2070 risk results, where you see some of the hotter areas are higher risk, probability and criticality, and that informed some of the selections for adaptation. So this was the end, the result of the vulnerability assessment. This was the last thing that we left you with during the vulnerabilities workshop, a list of high priority roads based on probability of flooding, risk, potential high tide flooding over time. And town staff selected two segments and expressed interest in a third. So we looked at Route 6A crossing Stony Brook. We looked at Lower Road near Bloomer Path. And then Dennis was already looking at Route 6A crossing Quivett Creek, at the top of Quivett Creek. And so we were doing some adaptation designs for that segment. And since it extends into Brewster, we're going to show you those designs now as well. Any questions on process before I go into the next set of slides, which is focused on adaptation?
Not seeing any hands.
Okay, so the first road segment that we'll talk about is Route 6A at Betty's Curve, crossing Stony Brook. It also comes down along Main Street and intersects Paint Creek Road to the east. We have two different cross sections for this road, and this is showing existing conditions. So the low spot on this road, the low point on this road, is at elevation 8.4 feet and AVD 88. It's not particularly at this cross section over the new culvert in over Stony Brook. It's actually the low spot by the intersection of Main Street and Paynes Creek Road. But along 6A, where the new box culvert, recently refurbished box culvert, is, we have a little bit higher elevation, and you see the water surface elevations symbolized by either colored blocks or colored lines across this cross section. So here it looks like a 2% annual chance water surface elevation would crest the roadway in this particular area. Further to the east at the intersection with Main Street and Paynes Creek Road, it's lower. And so a 10% annual chance water surface elevation, that light purple, is overtopping the road in that area. This has also an existing culvert there. It's smaller and the road is obviously lower. So these are the annual exceedance probabilities are under 2030 climate conditions, so more near to midterm. We were asked for this project to consider a range of alternatives for roadway adaptation, and those were gray, green, and hybrid. So gray is sort of traditional infrastructure, engineering, and construction. Green was looking at opportunities to use nature-based solutions to provide some flood protection and resilience. And hybrid was sort of a middle ground, maybe components of both. So we looked at ways to do that within the site constraints, considering elevation tie-ins, regulatory constraints in terms of, you know, minimizing impacts to wetlands. And we looked for tie-ins on high points, and you'll see that there are elevations associated with a lot of these designs. Many of these can be phased in over time. So you might not go all the way up to, in this case, the 14 feet right away if you don't feel like you need to. But we were just looking at sort of highest tie-in points that made sense for each road segment. So in this case, for Route 6A at Betty's Curve, the gray solution that we developed was a simple parapet wall up to 14 feet and AVD 88. It runs along the north side of 6A and then continues along the back segment of some properties to the northeast behind Lower Road. And what that does is it provides a link to prevent flanking from that wetland that's running from the northeast. In order to make sure that the flooding isn't flanking underneath 6A, we would have to add a tide gate to both the box culvert over Stony Creek, as well as the secondary smaller culvert that was left in place when that project was developed. So pretty simple solution. It's mostly within the road layout. It is a little bit complicated by having to put some tide gates on the existing culverts. Here's what that looks like in cross section across Stony Brook. So in this case, you're not seeing the flood water propagate underneath or over the road because one, there's a tide gate installed on the downstream side of Stony Brook. This would be operable. It would only be deployed during a storm event. So the restoration project that's been done there would continue to function. It would only just be a limited time where you'd need to close the gate if you wanted to have that flood protection. And then overtopping of the bank across the roadway would be minimized by this parapet wall, which in this case would prevent flood surface elevations up to a very high level storm in the near term. The hybrid solution that we developed, and I think we weren't able to develop a green solution for this, a purely green solution for this area. But we did look at ways to integrate some natural habitat into this area. So in this case, we're using some native vegetated side slopes and some rain gardens where we can to both reduce flood risk and provide some stormwater management. But the primary element of this alternative would be to elevate the road. It's about 1,500 feet that we have drawn here, up to a tie-in point of 13.4 feet and AVD 88. The side slopes on either side that are drawn here would be vegetated with natural salt-tolerant vegetation. But running through the wetland in order to reduce impacts to the resource area, we'd use sheet pile and just bring the road up within the existing road layout. And then both culverts would remain open. The Stony Brook culvert would be left in place. In terms of the intersection of Main Street and Paynes Creek Road, that culvert could be increased in size, potentially to restore a little bit of wetland upstream while you're elevating the road. There is still a potential for a flanking pathway there. So the way to manage that in sort of a green approach was to create this berm that's running along Lower Road and Paynes Creek Road. So that would also be vegetated with native plants. Here's what this looks like in cross section. Again, you're getting up to a pretty high elevation. So in the near to midterm, that would be a pretty well protected roadway. The elevation would get you even out of that high intensity 0.1% 2030 water surface elevation. And same over by the intersection with Main and Paynes Creek, same elevation, similar exposure. Here you're seeing the elevated road is on top of a upsized culvert. So no tide control on either of these because the protection is primarily provided by the elevation of the roadway. We looked at sort of a way to compare these alternatives. And what you see in the table here is a description of the elements of these adaptations. The critical elevation is basically the low point of the road under existing conditions, and then the tie-ins that we developed for each alternative. So existing was 8.4. It has 20% chance of flooding under near-term conditions, and then would be subject to annual storm surge exposure in the mid to long term. Each alternative would actually reduce, as I said, the near term to, you know, basically you would not experience flooding on either of those roads. But as you experience more sea level rise and more frequent and more intense storms, that still could be overtopped. Both of those alternatives could still experience flooding, just pretty low probabilities. One thing to note is that the gray alternative, where we have just the parapet wall and the the parapet wall and the tide gate on Stony Brook, you're not elevating the road, right? So, and you also don't want to have the tide gate closed every day. So if and when sea level rise comes up to what the state has for sea level rise projections under 2070, the road would still be vulnerable unless you kept the tide gate closed every day, which would basically defeat the purpose of the restoration. Elevating the road within the existing footprint under that hybrid solution would get it out of that scenario. Looking at impacts to the resource areas, the gray solution with the parapet wall would be pretty minimal. The wall would be within the existing road layout. And you know, you would have an installation of a tide gate, but again, the operation of that would just be on storms. And you know, the thought would be that that would not really impact the salt marsh or Stony Brook at all. Possible positive impacts for the hybrid solution because of you know, basically creating some native habitat on those side slopes rather than just plain grass. And both are primarily due to keeping work within the existing road layout would have minor impacts to private property. I think with the location of that wall or berm to address the flanking path, you might be either on the edge of, on the forward edge of private property where, and maybe be able to fit it into the existing road layout, or be on the backside of private property, which, you know, would require some easements. We developed some planning level estimations of cost based on installed materials. And there's a note on the bottom there, 40% escalation through 2029 and a 15% contingency. We did not include design, permitting, mobilization, or other considerations here. It's just installed materials. We did consult with a contractor with experience with these types of projects. And so basically estimating an installed material cost for the gray alternative of $1.8 million, almost $1.9 million, and for the hybrid, a little above $3.8 million. Maybe I'll pause there for any clarifying questions on Betty's curve. Chris.
Oh, just kind of reading between the lines, one alternative would be to start off in alternative one in the gray, and then over time, as we approach 2070, raise the road and accomplish much the same as the second alternative. I'm not sure to save costs, but it would be something that could happen earlier.
Yeah, you mean you could explore different heights for a lot of these things and maybe phase in a different approach later on. That's a really good point.
Mm-hmm. Elizabeth. Oh. Elizabeth.
What is available for state and federal funds on this type of project?
So we're going to get into funding at the end, if you can bear with to the end.
Thank you.
Yep. Don't see any other hands right now.
All right, so we'll move to Lower Road. and this is a small segment south of Freeman's Pond near Bloomer Path. The existing conditions, we've got a low spot of about elevation 10.2. NAVD 10.2 feet NAVD 88. There's a small culvert underneath the road, and at the existing elevation at that spot, we've got a 20, 30, 5% annual exceedance probability water level that's cresting the road. And to our knowledge, there's no tidal control on that culvert right now. So the gray alternative that we developed here was looking at 780 feet of roadway elevated to 13.4 feet and AVD 88. It's a similar elevation to the one we looked at on 6A at Betty's Curve. The side slopes where we're not using sheet pile. So there's sheet pile where it's crossing the wetland to avoid impacts to the wetland. And then the side slopes in other areas are just regular grass vegetation. We would, while we're working on the road here, you'd increase the size of the culvert and then add a tide gate that could be added to restrict long-term flood pathways to the east. So that's what this looks like in cross-section, similar elevation to what we looked at before on 6A. So a very low probability, high intensity storm is not cresting this adaptation. So you got a 0.1% that's being kept out by here, the sheet pile, and in other areas would be the elevation with the side slope. The hybrid alternative that we looked at here was to construct a parapet wall and a berm to the same elevation. So the parapet wall kind of strings along the north side of lower road where it abuts the wetland. So we don't want to be putting fill in a wetland. So we use that strategy there and then prevent the flanking using a berm running in an existing right of way that's appears to be unused just west of Bloomer Path. And that would be planted with native vegetation. And then the tide flap could be added to the existing culvert so that, you know, water wouldn't pass under during a storm, it could drain out. Here's what that looks like in cross section. We have the tide flap preventing all of those storm surge elevations, water surface elevations from passing under the road, and the wall here in other places, the vegetated berm preventing the surge from overtopping the road. The comparative chart here is pretty similar because we have two alternatives that were able to reach the same critical elevation. So the reduced risk, you're going from a 20-30 5% annual chance to 20-30 0%, less than 0.1%. And then the protective value of that decreases over time, but still is pretty decent. You're talking about 0.5% annual chance and 5% annual chance over the long term. none of this, these areas are projected to be vulnerable to tidal flooding, so that wasn't an issue even under existing conditions. It's just a storm surge area. The gray and hybrid alternatives would have some, but we think minimal impacts to wetlands. We're trying to keep that all that impact within the existing road layout or outside of the resource area. And again, minor impacts to private property, depending on where you put that berm. I think one thing to consider over the long term here is the hybrid solution with a tide flap would prevent high tide flooding from coming up in this area. Although if we don't have it projected, it's probably not an area of long-term salt marsh transition. So you'd be able to drain the wetland to the east, but you wouldn't have anything coming through from the downstream side. Relatively smaller costs here, $870,000 for the gray solution and $220,000 roughly for the hybrid solution. I'll pause again and see if there are any questions on either of those.
Yes, Len, go ahead. Are you trying to unmute?
Sorry, thank you. Yep. The parapet wall, do you have a photo example of what that would look like?
I don't. I'm sure we could find one and put it up in a maybe on the website or distribute it to the town. It's basically like a concrete seawall type construction.
Okay.
Many of them can be built to be adjustable over time, so they might have a larger footing in case you want to build them higher later on.
Okay, thanks. And the 13.4 feet, is that measured from the ground or does it go underground? And
no, 13.4 is an elevation. So in this case, the existing road surface on Lower Road is at elevation 10.2. So that's in reference to the National North American Vertical Datum of 1988. It's a standard elevation datum. So it's a relative, it's not relative to sea level rise, it's relative to the benchmark of NAVD 88. So I would compare, if you're talking about like how high the road is going to go, you're subtracting 13.4 from 10.2.
Okay. So forgive me if I'm missing this, but if a wall is built and I'm walking along the road,
yeah,
how high is the parapet wall?
In this case, it is about a little over 3 feet.
Great.
So a lot of time we try to keep things so that, you know, as you're driving along or walking along, you still have views of the wetlands.
That's exactly my point, especially on Payne's Creek. There's a whole view looking out that way. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yep. In some cases, we've actually done a combination of elevating the road and a parapet wall to prep exactly for that purpose.
Thanks. Mm-hmm.
And we do have some photos, actually.
We do, okay.
Yeah, Joe, you had shared those earlier for the tear sheets. So we can extract those post those to that same Brewster, the low-lying roads part of, the Brewster part of the low-lying roads website, the solutions tab. And we'll post some images of parapet wall there. So I don't see any other hands raised at this point. Okay. So maybe we can move on to our last one.
Oh, one thing before we move on, sorry. So just a zoom out of this whole area where we have two major flood pathways coming up, Stony Brook, as well as through Freeman's Pond. Just to note that we have designed these two road segments to, you know, reduce flood exposure to a certain level. But at a certain level over time, in this case, we're looking at the water surface elevations associated with the bigger storms in 2050 conditions. There are some of those water surface elevations can actually overtop both of these solutions and then impact a portion of Lower Road that's in between both of these. So it's just something to be cognizant of. It might be another segment of road that you look at in the future. Under the near-term 2030 conditions, that flanking pathway, that connection between the two flood pathways doesn't occur. Okay, so the last one we'll talk about tonight is Route 6A at Quivett Creek. It's on the Dennis Brewster line. And there is an existing culvert at the top of Quivett Creek. It's a very low roadway. It's basically looks like it's almost in the wetland here. The low point that we determined for this area was 7.5 feet and AVD 88. It looks like that's what we have on this chart here almost. It's subject to annual flooding, 100% annual exceedance probability under 2030 conditions. And obviously you see that existing culvert. It's a small one underneath the roadway between the upstream and downstream wetland. Again, here, I think we have two alternatives, a gray and a hybrid. The gray would take approximately 2,400 feet of road and elevate it to elevation 13.5 feet and AVD 88. It's a combination, like you saw in some of those other ones, of sheet pile to minimize the impact on the wetland areas. And then normally traditionally vegetated side slopes, so grass side slopes on a 4-to-1 ratio in the other areas that don't have wetlands. The culvert is running under Route 6 would be replaced and increased in size, which could facilitate some wetlands, some salt marsh migration over time, wetlands restoration. And obviously this was developed for Dennis, but the converse is true. It require collaboration with the town of Dennis because it's right on the town line. This is a cross section right at the culvert. So you're seeing sheet pile on either side supporting the increase in elevation from 7.5 to 13.5. The culvert is larger, and we're basically allowing tides and storm surge to run through it. And the protective feature is based on the elevation of the roadway contained either by sheet pile or side slopes. Again, similar exposure situation. So you're looking at a protection from a 0.1% 2030 event, although over time that's going to decrease with sea level rise. The hybrid solution here was a little bit out of the box, I guess. So looking at more regional flood pathways coming up Quivett Creek and then also coming over from the west, which would be overtopping Sisuit Harbor. Mm-hmm. So we're not actually doing anything on the road here. We're looking at creating a berm to elevation 12 feet and AVD 88 on the west side along South Street. And that would just be a 3-to-1 side slope native vegetation. And then on the east side, kind of bracketing those two sources of flooding, there's an existing elevated path, almost like a vegetated berm already. And if you could find a way to increase the elevation of that causeway and then retrofit a culvert with an operable tide gate, you could have a way to cut off flooding from storm surge in that area. So that would require a concrete wing wall constructed to 12 feet and AVD 88. And as I said, a tide gate installed on that existing culvert and no work on 6A itself. Again, this would be a situation where you'd want to keep that culvert open in normal conditions so that you have a healthy salt marsh above it in Quivett Creek, but you're able to close it off for an incoming storm. This is what that would look like across the berm on Quivett Creek. So it's basically taking that existing culvert, increasing the height of the berm on top of it, supported by a wing wall, and you know, you could potentially keep some of the pedestrian use
along that area by creating a sort of a causeway on top of that berm.
So Joe, there's a question from Chris.
Yeah, go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, I was just gonna comment. So this is the old C Street. There is a culvert there, like you said, it's used as a walking path now from both sides, you know, both towns. I'm just curious that as the water levels come up in 2030, 2070, would there any concern be there from fetch? Because this is out in the open salt marsh. Would the wing wall have to extend the full length or just at the culvert? You really wouldn't want wave action or something like that to impact if it's in the middle of a salt marsh, you know, pretty for a small degree of fetch, but an occasional storm could hit it.
Yeah, no, that's a good point, Chris. We'd want to look at that in terms of future modeling if this was a design option that people wanted to pursue.
We did find there was enough space to get a berm with side slopes, which you can kind of see in the background on there. So in this version, there's only a wing wall at the culvert, but like Joe said, you'd have to explore the full design.
Yeah, thanks, Linnea. So getting that causeway up to elevation 12 feet NAVD 88 would provide protection up to the 1% annual chance event under 2030. So the 0.5, that yellow line, or a more extreme storm would still overtop it. Similar from the Susuwit Harbor side, that berm would be constructed and be exposed to similar water levels. So comparing those two approaches, you have an existing segment of 6A that's potentially exposed to annual flooding in the near term, and then potentially long-term high tide flooding. The gray alternative, basically doing work on the roadway to elevate it to 13.5, could get a lot of protective value in the near term, and then, you know, pretty decent in the mid to long term, still 1%, 100-year recurrence interval storm under 2050 conditions, and a 5% chance annual event under 2070. Because you're elevating the roadbed itself, it would no longer be subject to high tide flooding, even under a long-term high sea level rise condition. Alternatively, the hybrid approach, you'd have a little less protective value, still a decent amount of protection getting to 12 feet NAVD 88 with the operable tide gate, providing that being able to close that off in a storm. But as we mentioned before, for some of those other segments, it's not a thing that you want to be closing every day for tides. So this would be something that if you did see long-term high sea level rise rates, this might still be exposed to high tide flooding under 2070 conditions. It's a long way off. There's probably a lot of iterations of the roadway that might happen between now and then, which brings up the question of being able to adapt over time and phase in solutions over time, and pairing your design to the exposure that it's projected to be subject to over the design life of your roadway. So just a couple of other things to consider here. We think there's probably minimal impacts, or we've tried to have these designs have minimal impacts on resource areas and private properties, keeping within the road layout or existing right-of-ways and outside of the resource areas. There's a big difference in cost, though. Raising two long segments of roadway would be around the $6 million mark, whereas building a smaller berm and trying to leverage the existing berm across Quivett Creek would be in the range of $500,000. I think that said, there's going to be a lot more in terms of design and permitting when you're talking about that causeway across Quivett Creek. So just a couple things to consider there. Maybe I'll pause there for any questions on 6A at the town line.
Yes, Peter.
Yeah, thanks, Heather. Joe, for the gray alternative at this location, where you are proposing to increase the size of the culvert pretty significantly, and not have a tie gate, did you do any analysis on the impacts to the marsh and fishways south of 6A and to the properties up in that area?
No, that would also be something you'd have to look at further in design, but yeah, it's a good thing to note that, you know, if you're increasing the size of culvert, you could potentially be conducting floodwaters beyond and exposing other properties. So yeah, good point, Peter.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. That's something that would take more site-specific hydrodynamic modeling.
Yeah, Peter, go ahead.
Is this a follow-up? Because this location is being considered both by Dennis and by Brewster. It's obviously straddles the town line. Have you had this session yet with Dennis residents? Yes.
Yeah.
And has the feedback from the community there been inclined to address this site? Or I know that you're looking at a couple others for there. Maybe it's too early to tell. I'm just curious if there's consensus with our neighbors about this site being at the top of their list.
Yeah, I'll jump in. Tom Andre, the town engineer, was sort of the main staff person from Dennis at that meeting. And this is definitely a priority for him. He's very interested in moving this forward. He's also very aware that it's a roadway controlled by MassDOT and the need to coordinate with them. We have that on our to-do list also, is to the extent that we interact with MassDOT, advocate for elevating this on their to-do list. This is not an area that I work in regularly, but we, Colleen Medeiros, who's our transportation program manager, has been part of this team and she's aware of this also. So we'll be carrying that message forward.
Yeah, I just think it's important for us to know that if Dennis is looking to advance this, we have no choice but to work together on the solutions and design and you know, engagement and the entire process. So appreciate
agreed.
That.
Agreed. You. Yeah, definitely. A lot of coordination needed on multiple levels. Chris, do you want to make a comment?
Yeah, if I could make one other comment. We did the culvert down towards Betty's Curve. It must be 12 or 13 years ago now. We're looking at 2070. That's probably near the end of the design life of a structure that was put in that far back. Have you had any experience with MassDOT when they're crossing these large segments of you know, basically separated salt marsh? Did they look at bridges or segments where a bridge might make more sense than redoing culverts?
They could.
Get
yeah.
more sediment, you could get more elevation, you could really restore more salt marsh if at least a portion of these was converted to a bridge.
Yeah. We could definitely look at that, and that could be suggested to MassDOT. It has come up in a couple other projects that we know of that are a little bit more sensitive in terms of the resource areas, you know, and don't have a big culvert already. But, you know, the thinking is maybe a bridge is the right solution to avoid any salt marsh impacts.
Yeah.
But yeah, we didn't look at that here. But it's definitely something that could be pursued. Much more expensive, obviously.
Right. All right. Any other clarifying questions about this segment? All right. That sort of wraps up Joe's overview of the work that the Woods Hole Group has done to develop those design solutions. And thank you, Pete Van Oot. Glad you were able to join. So we can have a little bit of more discussion here if you know, sort of beyond the clarifying question phase, there aren't a lot of people on this call, so I'm not too concerned about crowd control, as it were, but happy to open it up for any discussion at this point before I get into next steps, which would include an overview of some of the funding opportunities. So Len, please.
I know there's a number of different options and possibilities here, but is there any idea of the scope of the amount of time for construction on one or more of these projects, how long it would take?
That's not my area, and I don't know if it's Joe's area either.
Not mine either, but I have seen some of these start to go forward. Permitting can take a while. Design could be a year or two. Permitting could be another year, and then construction 2 to 5, 1 to 3, depending on the size. Maybe some folks from the town have a better idea of that than I do.
Yeah, Peter, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, for two of these locations, it's on State Road.
Good point,
more funding for those projects, but they take a lot longer
to
secure the funding. And so I would expect like on the order of a minimum 4 to 5 years and potentially longer, unless we're lucky enough to secure some one-time supplemental budget or some other funding source. Typically for state road projects, those planning horizons are multiple years out, and that's to secure the funding, and then you start with design and permitting and so forth. So it's a relatively, I'd say it's not a short-term horizon, it's at least medium term, and really we're looking at long term.
Okay, thank you.
And that's kind of why when we have these cross sections that show the solution, we're showing the 2030s as like a near term, potentially what is exposed to when it would get constructed.
Yeah, go ahead, Peter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I your cost estimates are also looking out, assuming a 2029 construction with plus contingency, right? I mean, you're
correct.
You've added some pretty considerable annual escalation for.
Yeah, and what we heard from the contractors that we work with is that recently it's just been so unpredictable. So that I think they took a conservative approach there.
Yeah, you've included 40% escalation plus 15% contingency. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Not seeing any other hands. Maybe we'll just move on to the funding question and next steps. So starting with, we will, as I noted at the outset, be posting this recording, the slide deck. The designs are already posted to the Low-Lying Roads webpage for the town of Brewster. And there is the ability to provide comments. There's a comment form there that's available through a button, and it's very straightforward to use. So we invite people to provide any feedback that they have. Positive, negative, or otherwise, regarding any of these solutions through that form. We'll be bundling those comments up and sharing them back to the town as they come in. And really the next steps here are, the presentation of these solutions is sort of the culmination of our work under this grant. And next steps go back to the town to identify which projects are priorities within, the range of priorities that towns are addressing. you know, take any community feedback and then get into more detailed analysis and engineering and permitting for the solution that you might be interested in. And as we've just been discussing, these projects that are happening on state roadways are going to require another level of coordination with MassDOT. And in the case of 6A at the Dennis line, coordination with the town of Dennis as well. So we're happy to help with elements of that that are within our area of expertise and help move that forward. So funding sources, there's a number of funding sources that are now available. The federal bipartisan infrastructure law has made available new monies that are coming through Federal Highway Administration. There's a new program called PROTECT. I don't know a lot about it. I'm attending a webinar on it in the near future. But the idea is that it's geared toward specifically towards resiliency projects and habitat improvements as well. There's also an existing program through Federal Highway called the Culvert Aquatic Organism Passage Program, so specifically for culverts and allowing for fish passage, et cetera. And then there are other federal funds through other programs like the BRIC Building Resilient Infrastructure and Communities Program through FEMA, also the National Fish and Wildlife Fund makes a lot of funding available for projects that are going to improve habitat. I think arguments could be made depending on which solutions are identified to move forward with, that, you know, might make that make sense. In addition, the Natural Resource Conservation Service has been working for many years on Cape Cod with many communities. Chris may be working with them presently on projects, but they've brought through the Cape Cod Conservation District has brought a lot of money to the Cape, looking at fish passage improvement projects, stormwater improvement projects, and culvert replacements, like some of these we're talking about. So there are opportunities there potentially as well. And then for projects that are green or hybrid, the Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program may also make funding available. And specifically another state funding source for culvert projects is available through the Division of Ecological Restoration. So there are some interesting sources of money available that may make sense to bring to bear on some of these projects. So with that, I'll stop, see if there are any questions or other comments about that. And we're just over an hour, which is nice. Peter, yes, please.
Yeah, Heather, I just ask that following the presentation that you send over the material that you're posting on your project page, so that we can put it on the town website, on the homepage.
Sure.
So that residents don't have to go hunting for it on the commission's website.
Okay.
Just want to make it as easy as we can for people to provide feedback and give comments.
So would you like the materials that are already posted, like the design solutions in the PDF format, and then also the recording and slide deck?
I think so. Okay. Yeah, that would be helpful. And then people can follow the links and be able to weigh in.
Yep. Will do.
Thanks.
Okay. Yes. Kim.
Hi. Do you have a technical memorandum or something that describes the process you used in modeling the flooding? The devil's always in the details. And I just think as we look at these individual projects, it would be nice to know, you know, to what extent we're looking at bathtub versus inundation models and how the storm surge modeling is going on top of that. And it might be helpful when we're trying to pick a project, if you will.
Yeah, I think there's some material on the Lying Roads website about the process and some basics about the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model. I will say that it's not a bathtub model. It's a fully hydrodynamic probabilistic model. The details are in, there's a report on the Boston Harbor Flood Risk Model, which was the predecessor to this. And I believe that the technical report for the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model is a pending release. But it's not just a bathtub model. If you go back to the other recordings for the vulnerability assessments, there's a little more detail about how the model was developed and why and how it works.
Oh, that's terrific. Thank you. I'm sorry. I don't think I've seen those, so I will get caught up.
Yeah, it's not like a full technical report, but it's an overview of the process and how the model was developed and what it does.
Yeah, if you click on the link that, I forget whether it was Lene or someone, Tara, put into the chat earlier, that'll take you to the Lowlying Roads webpage. And there's that sort of basic overview of our process overall here, as well as the MCFRM. But there's also, Joe, there's a PDF that you had provided to us that I'm not finding on the webpage right now. So
yeah, there's a FAQ sheet.
Yeah, we can see if we can get that. We'll send that over with other materials.
Thank you.
To Peter Lombardi, yeah. Okay. Not seeing any other hands or comments. Thank you very much for your attention this evening and attendance and great questions. And send you on your way.